Let him be quick to give from what he owns. He shall not be slothful, nor shall he despise his servants. Rather, he shall consider them as his children. He shall take or give with pleasure, and he shall not neglect to give offerings for the Eucharistic sacrifice as well as incense. If a Christian is persevering in all this, he is an imitator of Christ, and shall sit on his right and sing laudes together with the angels. He shall receive the crown of life that Christ has promised to his beloved. O lover of God, do not love silver, for the love of money is the root of all evil. It is enough for us to find food and the necessary clothing. And in reference to us, it is written, Cast thy care upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. Be ready to hasten to church in all diligence without laziness, and do not fail to work with your hands, so that in all your days you may earn something to feed yourselves and the poor. Part 2. This part is in three subdivisions. The first deals with what parents must do for their children and what children must do for their blood parents. Teach your children, O parents, the word of God, and raise them well-disciplined and knowing God. Teach the trades which are useful to them, lest they be occupied with idle things, and contemplate leaving their parents and educators without any help. If parents neglect them and discipline them not, and the children therefore remain idle, the latter will be hard-hearted and unwilling to do good. You must not, therefore, fear to scold or to discipline them, putting fear in them, because if you discipline them, you will not kill them. Rather, you will give them life. As for the following words of Solomon, uttered in his wisdom, show, Reproach thy son so that he may refresh thee and may be of use to thee, for he is thy hope. And if thou beatest him with a rod, thou wilt deliver his soul from death. Teach your children the words of God, and prevent them from doing evil with strokes, to make them obey you, starting from their childhood. Teach them all the divine books, and do not leave them in idleness, lest they prevail over you and disobey your commands. Do not allow them to drink wine with their companions, because they will turn to evil deeds. If they sin because of the negligence of their parents, not only they, but also their parents shall be punished. Therefore, you must discipline them, and when they are ready for marriage, marry them to pure women. And Paul said, The children ought not to amass treasures for their parents, but the parents for their children. Children, obey your parents as you obey the Lord, for it is just. Be well with thee, and thou mayest be long-lived upon earth. And you, parents, provoke not your children to anger, but bring them up to be well-disciplined and to know the teachings of our Lord. Gloss 10. It is laid down in the canons of the kings, the firstborn is obliged before the Lord to take care of his father and his brothers after their father dies, and the brothers who want to know the justice of God and to be given to his obedience are obliged before God to obey their elder brother, and every chief is appointed next to his companion must do the same. The second subdivision deals with the love of husbands for their wives and the obedience wives owe to their husbands. Paul said in his letter to the Ephesians, Let women be subject to their husband as to the Lord, because the husband is the head of the wife, and husbands must love their wives as they love their own bodies. Let every one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife love her and fear her husband. In his first letter, Peter said, And so also you women, be subject to your husbands, so that those who do not obey the word may be won without the word by the good manner of you. O wives, when they consider the purity of your heart and your turning to penance and justice, and you shall adorn yourself thus, not with ephemeral ornaments or with plaiting of the hair or with rings of gold or with the putting on of fine dresses, but with the ornaments of man, which are hidden, the true ornaments which is found in a humble heart, an ornament that becomes not old, the ornament that is found in a peaceful mind, an ornament that is in God forever. The ancient holy women who trusted in God were so, and their ornament was to be in subjection to their own husbands. As Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him my Lord, so you, her daughters, in doing good deeds, be not frightened by anything which causes fear. And you men likewise dwell with them according to the knowledge and purity. Keep them as weak vessels and respect them, for they inherit with you the life everlasting. At the beginning of the Didaskalia, Peter said, O men, servants of God, every man among you shall bear the weight of his woman. He must not be haughty nor deceitful, but shall be merciful and upright. One who hastens to do that which pleases his wife, he shall not adorn himself to make another woman desire him, lest she sin by looking at him. Fear, O women, your husband, and be respectful towards him. Do not do next to the Lord only his pleasure. Be vigilant to give him rest and to serve him. A wise woman does every good thing for her husband. She supervises the work of her servants and uses her hands for useful things. Her fingers are strong enough to weave clothing for the poor and to make two dresses, one for herself and the other for her husband. When she walks through the street, she veils her head with her cope. She veils herself with purity to defend herself from the looks of wicked men. She adorns neither her head nor her face, for there is nothing which renders her ugly and makes adornment necessary. Let her droop her head and look at the ground, and let her always remain veiled. A free woman shall not leave her hair unveiled in the house of the Lord. She shall not give her children to wet nurses, nor shall she be slothful in administering her house, nor disobedient to her husband. Third subdivision, that servants must obey their masters, and the masters must love their servants. Paul has said in his epistle to the Colossians, Servants, obey your worldly masters in all things, not with find flattery towards them to be praised by men, but with peaceful heart, in the fear of God. Whatsoever you do for them, do it wholeheartedly, as if you were doing it for the Lord and not for men. And know that the Lord shall reward you in the day of his judgment. Because you serve Christ the Lord, the one who does wrong shall pay for the wrong he has done. And there is here no partiality or respect for anyone. Masters, deal justly with your servants, observing equality between them. You must be masters who forgive their faults in the knowledge that you have a master in heaven who is not partial, nor one who acts in respect of a person's faith. A good Christian despises not his servant, but considers them as his children. In the chapter of Sundays and Feasts, it is said that they shall have rest on those days. Part 3. Matters that entail punishment. A sorcerer who reads omens with fruits of trees, with shells, or on dust, one who evokes the dead, one who interprets dreams or explains magic science, one who foretells the future by watching the flight of birds, one who is superstitiously careful not to meet a lame or a blind person, one who foretells the future on the basis of people's talk, so also one who follows the customs of the heathen and the vain talk of the Jews, one who does foolish things, one who watches spectacles. All these people must abstain from these things, otherwise they must be chased out of the church. So also to a diviner, to one who gives shelter to sorcerers, or the priests and ministers of the devil, to one who hypnotizes others, to one who ties and unties magic knots or invokes the devil, to one who listens to magicians, to one who watches sunrise and moonrise attentively and acts on his observations, to one who wears amulets engraved with the devil's name, to one who holds a piece of iron to drive off devils, to one who uses a conjurer's tricks, and to one who dances with his feet. Gloss 11. The following is laid down in the canons of the apostles, and was included in the canons by extraction from the precepts of Paul, a messenger or one who stands in the street holding a rod in his hands, one who tells false miracles, one who writes conjurations, one who frowns during misfortunes and grumbles against the judgments of God, and one who tattoos his hands with a needle shall be chased out of the church. Chapter 12 on Mass. Chapter 12 on Mass. In church, people must attend Mass quietly, with purity, with great attention to hear the word of God, with great care, each one in his proper place, according to the positions of the Heavenly Spirit. The bishops, in their capacity as rulers, in front of the altar, behind them the priest as teachers, and on the side of the bishop, the archdeacon, and the deacons shall stay behind the priest as ministers, and behind them, all the people, young in one place, separated from the others, and if there isn't room enough to accommodate them, the boys shall be grouped separately, otherwise they shall stay with their fathers. Similarly, women shall stay separately in one place, those married to one side, and girls to the another. If there is no separate place for the girls, they shall stay behind the women. The virgins and the widows, however, shall have priority over all the women in occupying places as well as in intoning the prayers. The king shall stay in the sanctuary with the chief and rulers. The deacons shall assure that everyone stays in his appropriate place and shall watch the people lest some slumber, sleep, laugh, or deride their companions. Whoever laughs during Mass shall be awarded 1 week of fasting as his punishment. If he is a priest, and if he is a layman, he shall be sent out immediately and shall not receive the Eucharist. No one shall talk at the sanctuary or around the sanctuary unless it is necessary. And no one shall spit while he is at the sanctuary unless he is ill. No one shall utter vain talk in the church, because the house of God is not a place of conversation, but a place of prayer with fear of God. One who talks in church shall go out, and for that one time he shall not receive the holy mysteries. Unless it is necessary, no one shall go out of the church after the reading of the gospel, and before the end of Mass, the benediction of the priest, and the dismissal of the people. Whoever enters the church and hears the holy books and does not stay in the church until the end of prayer must be segregated. The vestments with which Mass is celebrated shall be white, as is becoming to priest, and not of varied colors. Moreover, our Lord's clothing became as white as light when he was transfigured. Also, the appearance of angels who announce good news to men is of this color. God commanded the children of Israel to come to him in this fashion on the day he spoke to them. This vestment must reach to the feet of the priest, and a wide piece of cloth shall be placed on his shoulders. The Mass vestments shall be kept in the house of the servant of the church, or in the place where the church books are kept. The vestments shall not be kept outside this place. No one shall put on shoes at the sanctuary, since the highest God said to Moses, Take off the shoes from thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy. He said the same thing to Joshua, the son of Nun, disciple of Moses. The Mass shall not be begun until all the people are gathered. The deacon shall carry the Eucharist to the sanctuary, and if the celebrant is a bishop, the priest shall stand at his right and the left, like his disciples. It is not proper that the priest celebrate Mass without a deacon to announce the prayer to the people and preach to them with fear and honor. He must be capable of making himself heard by the people. The celebrant shall begin the Mass with the prayer of thanksgiving. Next he shall explain the word of the holy books. Then the priest shall bring the loaf of bread and the Eucharist chalice, and the bishop shall take the thurible and shall go around the altar thrice in honor of the Holy Trinity. He shall give the thurible of incense to the priest, so that the latter may go with it around all the people. At the end of the singing, the deacons shall read some verses from the letters of the apostles and the laudes from the psalms, and after this they shall read the holy gospel while the people stand up in silence. The reader shall be a priest or a deacon. When the reading of the gospel is over, if a bishop is present, he shall take the gospel in his hands and shall explain the verses which were read to the people. If the bishop is not present, the priest who can explain it shall do so. If you speak in a different language and do not explain what you say, how shall it be possible for others to understand what you say? Because then you shall be like the one who speaks into the wind. They shall speak one by one, and another shall interpret to him. But if there is no one to do the interpretation, the person who speaks a different language shall keep silent in the church. After the explanation of the gospel, the celebrant shall pray for the sick, the pilgrims, and the afflicted, the winds, the fruits of the land, the king, the dead, those who bring offerings for the Eucharist to the church, those who built that church, the catechumens, the peace of the universal church, the bishops, the clergy, and the community of the people. The bishop shall celebrate the Mass, standing near the altar, with the curtains drawn. The priest shall stay behind the curtains, and the deacons shall stand around the altar, fanning the air with fabula in the likeness of the wings of the cherubs. Two deacons shall stand at the side of the altar, and shake the fabula made of soft material, and drive away the little flies, lest any of them drop into the chalice. A deacon shall stay with the priest to serve him, and shall say to the people that anyone who does not give up fraud or false pretense between himself and his companion must not receive the Eucharist. After this, he shall bid each one of the men to give each other chaste kiss of peace. Then all men shall salute each other with a holy salutation. Women shall salute women, and men shall not salute women. The deacon shall bring water. Then the priest shall wash their hands, and the deacon shall say, "You who do not receive the Eucharist, get out." After this, the archpriest shall pray to the people and shall finish the Mass. The people shall pray in a low voice. Those who sing at the sanctuary shall sing not with abandon, but with intelligence. The priest shall divide the Eucharist slowly, piece by piece, and shall be careful that none of it falls on the ground. And he shall divide it equally, so that the piece may not be too small or too big, but shall be such as to fill the mouth of the person who receives it, and such that the receiver can roll it inside his mouth. The sign of the Holy Cross shall be engraved into each loaf, and on it all parts of it. After all the prayers have been said, the priest shall make the profession of faith in the name of the Trinity, and all the people shall cry together and say, "Amen, we believe." The priest shall say, "Through the deacon, he who is pure, let him receive the Eucharist, but he who is not pure, let him not receive it, so that he will not burn in the fire of the divinity." Those who have enmity towards their companion, those who have thought of fornication and drunkenness, and those who were not present at the beginning of Mass may not receive the Eucharist. The priest who was not present at the beginning of the Mass must not receive the Eucharist nor take the Holy Body with his hands. There are three Masses in the Coptic Church, those of Basil, Gregory of Cyril, and they are the Masses that are celebrated. Chapter 13, Eucharist. No priest shall bring honey, milk, birds, or meat of any animal to the holy altar as an offering. If any priest brings for an offering something other than that commanded by the Lord, he shall be deposed, unless it is pure oil to be used for lighting, or incense to be used during the pure Mass. No offering shall be brought to the altar except the host of pure wheat, and the juice of pure grapes. The wine shall not be replaced by any intoxicating drink prepared with the help of fire. The fruit of the ear, or of wheat, shall be offered in its season, and the grape during its feast, when it begins to ripen. The offering shall be prepared from what the church has, but if it has nothing, the offering shall be made and prepared from the offering brought to the church by the faithful. Eucharist shall be offered every week on Sunday, Wednesday, Friday, and Saturday, and on feast days, if they fall on weekdays. Only the oblation of the good Christian shall be offered during the Mass. The offering of the following people shall not be accepted, namely, blasphemers, murderers, idol worshippers, thieves, idol makers, drunkards, those who oppress widows and orphans, publicans and robbers, wicked soldiers who vex the poor, those who put people in fetters unjustly, those who rule with tyranny over their subjects and ill-treat them, those who act unjustly and with oppression, merchants who sell wine mixed with water, and all the transgressors of the law. The Lord abhors the offering of impious, as the wise Solomon has said, "Do not sell, O priest, your first birthright by receiving something from one who lives in sin." Similarly, do not receive the offering of those expelled from the church, whom the church has excommunicated. Only members of the faithful and those who have not been expelled shall receive the Eucharist. If any member of the faithful is excommunicated and put with those who are out of the church, and his day of death approaches, he shall not be prevented from receiving the Eucharist. If he recovers from his sickness, he shall take part in the prayer of the faithful, and shall not be put back to the status of those who are outside. One who is possessed by evil spirits, provided he does not blaspheme and does not slaver after he falls down, shall be given the Eucharist on feast days. The deacon shall write down daily the names of those who bring offerings, be they living or dead, in order to remember them during the prayer and reading, and the singer inside the curtains and all the people together shall pray for them. The bread which is offered on the altar of sacrifice shall be a new loaf. It must not be saved for the following day, but must be distributed on that day. Nothing shall be left for another day. The bread must not have cracks in it, and must be without any stain. The wine shall be poured into the chalice, and shall be observed carefully to see that it is pure. It shall not be offered if it is not limpid and pure. He who prepares the chalice shall not pour into it old wine, and shall not add water in excess of one-third of the wine. If there is ample wine, he shall add only water equal to one-tenth of it, and shall not vary this proportion. If he dares to change the said proportion, he shall be expelled. He shall not fill the chalice to the brim, and in excess of its measure, lest the wine be spilled on the ground. No one shall receive the Eucharist unless he fasts with purity, and if any faithful man or woman has tasted food and then dares receive the Eucharist, he shall be perpetually expelled from the Church of the Lord. Every member of the faithful shall prove himself ready to receive the holy mysteries before tasting anything, especially in the days of fasting. If he has fasted, let him receive the Eucharist, and if one gives him bodily poison, it will not harm him. Every member of the clergy must be careful lest anyone receive the holy mystery without being a member of the faithful. The following is laid down in one of the canons of the kings. The faithful, men or women, men and women, shall always stand during the prayer of the Eucharist, singing laudes and beseeching God, and shall restrain themselves from speaking in the church. If someone is about to put an offering at the altar, but remembers that his brother is angry with him, he must leave his offering before the altar and go first to reconcile himself to his brother. Then he may come back and leave his offering. The man who eats of the body of the Lord and drinks of his blood unworthily sins against the body of our Lord and his venerated blood. Therefore, let a man examine himself first and make his soul good and saintly. Then let him eat of that bread and drink from that chalice. For he who eats and drinks of it unworthily eats and drinks perdition to himself. He does not know the body of the Lord, and does not discern it from other things. Therefore are many infirm and ill among you, and many who die suddenly. Gloss from the Pentateuch. If anyone eats of the sacrifice of the Lord while defiled, his soul shall be cut off from his people. If the bishop of or any priest offers a sacrifice and does not take from himself, he shall give the reason for this his doing so, and when he gives it, he shall be forgiven. If he does not give his reason, he shall be put apart, because he will not have made the people suspicious that he celebrated the Mass without purity. The bishop shall receive the Eucharist first, then the priest and deacons, and after all of them the people. Women shall receive it after men. All the faithful shall sing during the reception of the Eucharist. When the priest gives the body of Christ, he shall say, "This is the body of Christ that he gave for our sins." And the one who receives it shall say, "Amen." Similarly, the one who holds the chalice shall say, "This is the blood of Christ that has been shed for us." And he who receives it shall say, "Amen," and shall receive it with great fear and purity. The priest and deacons shall take care that nothing of the Eucharist remains, because a great judgment shall weigh upon them. What remains in the chalice shall be taken by all the deacons who serve at the altar. Everyone must be careful not to leave remnants with the purpose to eat it, as ordinary food, lest what befall them, the sons of Aaron and Eli, when they defiled the sacrifice of the Lord, befall them. When the singers have finished singing lauds to the Lord, the deacon shall say loudly, "We have received of the venerated body of Christ. Let us thank the one who makes us worthy to receive it." After this, the bishop shall pray, thanking the Lord for the holy mysteries they received. When the priest is through with the prayer, the deacon shall say, "Bow your heads in front of the Lord, that he may bless you." And the bishop shall recite the prayer of benediction, after which the deacon shall say, "Go ye in peace." After the thanksgiving is over, nothing shall be left in the chalice prepared for the service to wait for the one who did not come to the church during the Mass. No one shall drink water, nor shall anyone cover the Eucharist he received with bread before the dismissal, and from the water taken to wash the mouth afterwards. Nothing shall trickle out of the mouth. Chapter 14. Prayer. Prayer is the talking of man to the highest God, whereby he thanks him, praises him, and recognizes his dominion, confessing his sin and seeking on his part the way of pleasing him. And there are precepts concerning one who prays. First of all, he shall stand up, as in the words of our of the Lord, "When you rise up for your prayer, you shall stand up," and also the words of David, who said, "In the morning I will stand before thee, and will appear before thee." The second precept is to gird oneself with a girdle, as the Lord hath said, "Let your loins be girt." The third is to turn one's face towards the east, because that is the direction from which Christ, may he be praised, has said he will appear in his second coming, and because the prophet David had said in Psalm 67, "Sing to God who has risen to the heavens, and from heaven, from the east side, has made his voice heard, the voice of power." The law provides and commands that one who prays must turn his face in this direction from which his voice has been heard and from which he will come. Accordingly, he must not turn his head this way and that, as the Lord said to the children of Israel the day he spoke to them. The fourth is to make it the sign of the cross in the likeness of the cross, from the forehead downward and from the left to the right. Crossing oneself is meant to drive away the devils, as our Lord had said, "If I, by the finger of God, cast out devils," and also the sign of the cross is made from the forehead downward and from left to right, to signify that our Lord descended from heaven to earth and transferred us from the left side to the right. Moreover, one crosses oneself because God with his cross accomplished the redemption, and also because in this way we remember the grace of the one who has crucified for us. The apostles as well commanded the same thing. Every time we cross ourselves in the likeness of the cross, we do it with heartfelt faith to keep away the devil. The apostles put this sign on us so that through it we may be saved from perdition, as God put the sign on the Paschal Lamb on the house of the children of Israel as a sign that would prevent death, lest he kill their firstborn as he killed the firstborn of the Egyptians. The times when one must cross oneself are at the beginning of prayer, and whenever mentioned of the cross is made. The fifth condition is to recite the words of the prayer with fear and trembling. This must be done in such a way that the spirit moves towards the Creator, either in thought only or with the tongue, which interprets the thought. The sixth is to kneel down and prostrate yourself with your face on the ground, since our Lord has said, "It is written, the Lord thy God shalt thou adore, and to him only shalt thou prostrate thyself." The Gospel also testifies that our Lord prayed in the night of his passion and prostrated himself and knelt down, and our adoration must be in spirit and truth. As our Lord, may he be praised, has said, "The times of adoration and their number are fixed in our church. Whosoever prays shall prostrate himself when there is mention of the adoration of the highest God at the time of prayer. He shall begin the prayer by prostrating himself once or thrice, and so also at the end of prayer. He shall recite the psalms and the hymns. There are some who do only half of these as prostration and do the other as genuflections. And there are others who go beyond this according to their constitution and strength. As for the fixed times during which the prostration is substituted for by genuflections, they are Sundays, the days of Pentecost, the feast days of Our Lord and Our Lady, and also, after receiving the Eucharist, during prayer one must raise one's hands with palms outstretched and open, especially at the time of supplication, since Paul said to Timothy, I wish that men pray in every place by lifting up their hands in purity without anger or contempt, as the prophet David said in Psalm 133, In the night lift up your hands in the holy place and bless the Lord, and as he also said in Psalms 87 and 142, I lifted up my hands to thee, and also lift your eyes towards heaven as our Lord, may he be praised, did when he raised Lazarus, and as the prophet said in Psalm 122, Unto thee, O Lord, we lifted up our eyes, and also strike your beast when you ask for forgiveness and during penance in order to free yourselves from sin, to repent for the day spent without doing good, as the publicans who struck his beast in prayer who was praised by our Lord. It is also commendable to shed tears if one can do it, as David and the saintly father did. What must be recited during the prayer is written in the gospel and the canons. You shall pray thus, Our Father, who art in heaven until the end. And the faithful shall say the creed at the end of every prayer. The greater part of the daily prayers to be said, night and day, shall be from the Psalms of David, because in them there are prayers of thanksgiving, laudes, supplications, professions of the unity of the Creator, and confessions of sin. In the morning prayer, Psalm 62 shall be recited, and in that of the evening, Psalm 140. The priest shall recite every day the canticle of the three young men, and shall always finish their prayer with the prayer of Our Lady Mary. On Monday, they shall recite the canticle sung by Moses and his sister when they came out of the sea, and when the highest God saved them on Tuesday, the priest shall recite the canticle of Deuteronomy. On Wednesday, the prayer of Anne, the mother of Samuel. On Thursday, the prayer of the prophet Habakkuk. On Friday, the prayer of the prophet Isaiah. On Saturday, the prayer of Jonah. And on Sunday, they shall recite all of the above prayers. The Father hath prescribed other prayers in addition to those which must be recited. The faithful must say their prayers 7 times a day. First, before sunrise, when people awaken and rise from bed. They must pray after they wash their hands with water. Let everyone pray before beginning work. The second is the prayer of the third hour. The third, the prayer of the sixth hour. And the fourth, the prayer of the ninth hour. The fifth, the evening prayer. The sixth, the prayer of sleeping hour. The seventh, the prayer of midnight. After washing the hands with water, if water is not available at the moment, they shall blow on their hands and shall cross themselves with saliva from their mouth. If one is in the company of his wife, both shall pray together. But if she is not a Christian, the husband shall move away from her and pray alone. Those who are bound by marriage shall not skip prayer. They need to take a bath before praying. It is enough if they wash their hands, for their marriage is pure. The reason why one must pray 7 times a day is that David said, 7 times a day I give praise to thee, O Lord. One prays in the morning because the Lord has made the light shine on us and has made darkness disappear. At the third hour, because Pilatus condemned our Lord at that hour. At the sixth hour, because our Lord was crucified then. At the ninth hour, because then he passed away. At night you shall praise the Lord, because he has given you rest from the toils of the day. You shall praise the Lord at these times, because he accepted pain, crucifixion, bitter gall, death, and the descent into the tomb at sunset. The midnight prayer is prescribed because the bridegroom comes at midnight, and because David has said, I rose at midnight to prostrate myself before thee. At midnight also, Paul and Silas prayed in prison, and our Lord also prayed thrice during the night of his passion, and said, Watch ye and pray, that ye enter not into temptation. He also said, Watch ye, for you know not when the Son of Man comes, if he comes at midnight, or at the cock crow, or in the morning. The morning and evening prayers shall be said in the church, especially on Sundays and Saturdays. And whosoever skips prayer, unless he is ill, shall be cut off from the congregation of the faithful. If one who is sick can come to church, he must not miss it, for he may be healed by the holy water and the oil he takes. If he is a sick person who cannot come, his acquaintances shall visit him every day. The prayer of the third hour and the rest must be said at home. And when any of these times of prayer arrive, and the member of the faithful finds himself in a place where he cannot pray, he shall pray mentally. The prayers reserved to the priest must be said only in the church. These prayers are the prayer of baptism, the prayer of sacrifice of Mass, the prayer for the ordination of priests, the prayer for the consecration of the altar, the prayer for the consecration of the church, the nuptial prayer, the prayer of absolution, the prayer to heal the sick, the prayer for the dead at the moment of their passing, and thereafter, the prayer over the oil, and thus the first fruits of the edible thing, and every prayer to be said for any necessity. At the end of prayer one shall say, Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and the Holy Spirit. World without end. Amen. The prayer of baptism and the prayer said during the ceremony of the washing of the feet, as mentioned in the Gospel, are taken from the book of the Mass. The prayers that are not compulsory are the prayer of devotion, proper to monks and those who live in the fear of God, for they pray more night and day, as it is said in the teachings and in the parables of the Lord and in the following saying of the Apostle, Pray without ceasing. The Apostle also said, Be instant in prayer. Monks consider morning prayer at cock crow as compulsory, pursuant to what is said in the canons. David said in Psalm 56, I will arise early and confess to thee. There are also prayers of mealtime to be recited at the beginning and at the end of meals, at the beginning of the meal, so that the Lord may bless the food which is to be eaten, and at the end of the meal, so that the Lord may render the food suitable for the preservation of the body and health, and so that a monk may have the strength to continue the ascetic life he lives in. Priests used to sit down and to recite it with the people, as our Lord did when he looked at heaven and blessed the five loaves. There is the prayer for those who travel, like the prayer Paul said when the Ephesians accompanied him on his departure. And when he left Tyre to travel to Achaia, there is also the prayer the monks shortened and adapted to be recited when they enter their houses and when they go out. There is the prayer, the purpose of which it is to bring an end to tribulation. This prayer is divided into two parts, and the prayer a man says for himself. And the prayer a man says for others. The first is in accordance with what was said by the Apostle, If any one of you is in tribulation, let him pray. So that also Paul, Jonah, and the three young men prayed in the tribulation and were saved. Our Lord also has taught us this with his prayer during the night of his passion. As for the prayer for others, the Acts of the Apostles testify that the church prayed for Peter when he was in prison, and Paul also said, Pray for me that I may be saved. There is the prayer for forgiveness of sins, the prayer of the priest for the people, such as Moses, Aaron, and Phinehas prayed. There is also the prayer for obtaining what one desires. By that prayer, a desire not forbidden by the law is fulfilled, as when one asked for offspring or wisdom. Thus was the prayer of Anne by which Samuel was given, and her canticle when she gave birth to him. It is as said by the Apostle, Whosoever wants wisdom, let him ask God, who gives abundantly. Do not doubt, for he gives to those who ask. And also in conformity with the saying of our Lord, All things whatsoever you ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. There is also the prayer of the spiritual fathers for the children. such as the prayer said by Paul, and his command to his disciple Timothy about it. One shall not pray with an excommunicated priest, nor with an infidel, even if it is in a house. Whosoever prays with them shall be deposed. You, O brothers, pray always so that those who are inclined to anger without reason may desist from anger. When an important person, be he a stranger or from the country, comes in, do not cut short your talk, O bishop. But the brethren shall receive this person among them, and the deacon shall give him a place fit for him, so that the deacon's office may please God. Gloss. It is said, in the canons of the kings, a woman who is menstruating and a newly delivered mother shall say their prayer at home and not in the church. Chapter 15. On all the fasts. Fasting is abstinence from food. It is observed by man at certain times determined by law to attain forgiveness of sins and much reward, obeying thus the one who fixed the law. Fasting also serves to weaken the force of conspicuous sins so that the body may obey the rational soul. All the faithful are obliged to observe the fast of 40 days as did Christ, may he be praised. The fast which comes to an end on the Friday of Vesh, and after it, the fast of the week of crucifixion. These fasts shall be observed until the end of the day, and during that time, no blooded animal, nor what is produced by animals shall be eaten, and also the fast of Wednesdays and Fridays of every week shall be observed, except during the 50 days, and during the feast of Christian and baptism. When these feasts fall on these days, on fast days, one must fast until the ninth hour, as it is written. There are other fasts which have been established by the Coptic Church. Some of these are similar to the Lenten fast in the strictness of the provisions regarding the observance. These are the week of Herkal, which falls before the great fast, the three days fast of the people of Nineveh, the fast of the eve of Christmas, and the fast of the eve of baptism. Other fasts are less strict, like the fast of Wednesday and Friday, such as a fast is the fast preceding Christmas, which begins at the middle of Hadar and ends on the feast of Christmas. There is also the fast of the apostles, which follows the feast of the Pentecost and ends on Hamlet 5th, which is the feast of Peter and Paul. These fasts must be observed in their entirety because they were observed by the people together with many patriarchs who number exceeds that of bishops gathered at a few councils whose canons are observed. Finally, there are some fasts which are observed by many people. Such is the fast of preceding the fast of Our Lady, which is observed mainly by hermits and monks. It begins on the first of Nehasi and ends at the feast of Our Lady. In the fast laid down by law, one shall fast until the ninth hour of the day. No meat shall be eaten during the period unless it is fish. He who observes a fast must strictly then be in command, is commanded shall receive a greater reward on Sunday and on Saturday. One shall not fast, however, one shall abstain from milk products. Fasting is the tribute of the body, just as giving alms is tribute of wealth. The purpose of the law is imposing fasting. Fasting is to weaken the force of conspicuousness and to make the latter submit to the rational soul, just as the purpose of prayer is to make the force of anger submit to the mind. And through the benefit we derive from fasting, we resemble spiritual beings. With this resemblance, he who emulates gains the power to approach the spiritual model. Fasting is commendable, as the person who fasts is enabled to realize the suffering of hunger and may have pity for the hungry and those who ask for alms. One must also fast in order to receive the Eucharist, having the ardent desire to be fed with it, and in order to receive it with a spiritual and corporeal eagerness. One must also fast in order to give worship to the Lord in every way, by fasting properly. Thus, when one fasts, he worships the Lord with the animal half of his nature, whereas with prayer he worships the Lord with the spiritual half of his nature. And in the canons laid down on fasting, it is written, The Lenten fast that begins on the second Monday of the week and ends on the Friday preceding Fesh, that is, the week subsequent to which the week of the Fesh comes, shall be preserved among you. After that, you shall be careful and complete the week of the Holy Easter after the Lenten fast. Gloss. The week preceding the week of Easter is known as the week of Fesh. And so they have commanded us to fast on 6 days of the Holy Week, and to fast on Wednesday and Friday of every week. On Wednesday, because a consultation was made that day, and on the Friday, because the will of our Lord was done. People shall rest from fasting on the seventh day. At cock crow, one shall not fast on Saturday, for on that day the Lord rested from his work. But on the day, Holy Saturday, one shall fast, because on that day the Creator of all creatures was lying in a tomb. In these 6 days, one bread, salt, and water shall be taken. You shall abstain from wine and meat on these days, because they are days of sorrow and not days of feasting. You shall fast on Friday and Saturday of the Holy Week, and whosoever can shall on these days not take anything until cock crow at night. If someone cannot fast on both days, he shall observe the fast of Saturday. Our Lord has said in reference to himself, when the bridegroom shall be taken away from them, then they shall fast. You shall fast on these days until night, as we did when he was taken from us. After the celebration of the Feast of Pentecost is over, you shall celebrate again another week, and then you shall fast. Having rested, again, we command you to do fast on every Wednesday and Friday, and if can, fast more than this, do it, and give alms to the poor. Gloss. Of the chosen teacher who compiled this book, may the Lord have mercy on him. The proof that we must not eat during the week is that at the place where we are commanded to fast on Wednesdays and Fridays, Pentecost, Christmas, and baptism are also mentioned as the days on which we are permitted to eat, but nothing is said about this week. If it were similar to the days on which one is permitted to eat and not to fast, such as the above days, it would have been mentioned explicitly. Moreover, this week is not included in the days on which we are commanded not to fast, and not to prostrate ourselves as happens on Sundays and Saturdays, and the Feast of the Lord. Also, he who has failed to observe his duties during the Holy Week has been commanded to postpone them until the Feast of Pentecost is over. Then, if one were permitted to eat in the week of the following, the Feast of Pentecost, after having eaten for 50 days, it would have said, and also, eat in the week following the Feast of Pentecost. Moreover, the word used is celebrate. Therefore, we regard this week, it has been said only, make a feast, which does not mean to eat. Gloss. Thus, it shows that the fast of Wednesday and Friday must be observed during this week. It does not prove that one must spend due week eating. Basil and Chrysostom have said that to celebrate does not mean to eat. And it is known that to celebrate on fast days consists of reading what is appropriate to the feast and not of eating on that day. The canon has commanded us then to celebrate for 3 days. When a bishop is consecrated, it is known that we do not eat during those days if they fall on fast days, nor is the feast celebrated with eating. Moreover, they have ended this canon by saying, if you can fast more than this, do it. Therefore, if disputed should arise on fasting, to fast is better than to eat. Also, there were councils held by few as 20 bishops. We have observed the fast during the week in the lifetime of many patriarchs of Alexandria, whose number is more than 20. If we fail to observe what is the same as the command of a council, it would not be a good thing. It would be an act of contrary to the council, especially because it would make an opposition to the perfection of our law, made up of a bad thing, namely, making our greed for food manifest. Moreover, as Moses fasted before announcing to the people the law of the Pentateuch, he received from the Lord in the feast of 50 days. Our Lord also fasted after the descent of the Holy Spirit on him, before giving him law to the people. So the apostles also fasted when the Holy Spirit descended upon them on the feast of Pentecost before preaching the Christian law to the people. And we are guided by them in this matter, the end of the gloss. If Christmas coincides with and falls on a fast day, that is, Wednesday or Friday, the faithful shall pray and receive the Holy Mystery and shall not break the fast until the ninth hour. If one is traveling at sea and does not fast, because he is unaware of the days of the Holy Week, he shall fast after the Feast of Pentecost. It is not the period of the Holy Week as such which he observes, but something like it. He must fast to compensate for missing it. Whosoever does not observe the Lenten fast and the fast of Wednesdays and Fridays, if he is a priest, shall be deposed unless he is visibly ill. If he is a layman, he shall be segregated. If a priest celebrates the Holy Week before night and day are equal, he shall be deposed. And those clergymen who fast on Sundays and Saturdays other than the great Saturday of the Holy Week shall be deposed. We must not celebrate the Feast of Martyrs during the Lenten fast. Rather, the commemoration of it. We must not celebrate the Feast of Martyrs during the Lenten fast. Rather, the commemoration of martyrs shall be celebrated on Sundays and Saturdays. No wedding shall be celebrated during the Lenten fast, nor shall there be any celebration if a woman gives birth to child then. And no people shall be invited to a drinking house to drink during the time. No clergyman shall drink wine during the Lenten fast, nor during the fast of Wednesdays and Fridays, nor shall he enter the public bath. Man shall not sleep with his wife on fast days. In case the Feast of Martyrs falls on a fast day, and the bishop or priest celebrates the feast and causes the people to eat on account of the death of the martyrs, he shall be deposed, for he has been the cause of scandal to many souls. If the people eat on their own will, the bishop or the priest shall expel them. It is not proper to eat on the feast days of martyrs when the feast falls on a fast day, since the martyrs were put to death and burnt with fire in a state of hunger and thirst. Regarding the days of Christmas and baptism, as well as the Feast of Pentecost, the Council of Nicaea commanded that the Mass be celebrated at night. During the Holy Lenten fast, for the first few weeks, shall fast until sunset. Afterwards, they shall fast until the 11th hour. But during the days of the Holy Week, it shall be until the stars come out. No one shall wear ornaments on those days. Women shall put aside their ornaments. Everyone must avoid lying down with his wife during the Lenten fast and the Holy Week, because the redemption of and forgiveness of our sins occur during this period. It is an act of contrary to the law of marriage for one spouse to stay near to the other in bed during the Lenten fast. Woe to him who commits this sin in the days of the Holy Week. If we fulfill our will and pleasure in the Holy Lenten fast, where then will we be our joy to see the resurrection? And fasting does not consist merely of taking bread and water only. The fast which is acceptable before God is living in purity of heart. If the body is hungry and thirsty, but the soul eats whatsoever it likes, and the heart is entirely given to delights, what benefit derives from your fast? Gloss. One shall fast for 40 days with mortification and humility, and must abstain from taking milk products. No one shall get married, nor shall any baptism take place during the Holy Week. There shall be no ordination of priest or funeral services for the dead, and all must be fully devoted to the church in those days. On Psalm Sunday, therefore, the office of the dead, the book of the apostles, the gospel, and the absolution for those who will die during the Holy Week shall be read. On Thursday, the prayer of salutation, the prayer of Lord of Living, and the prayer of benediction shall not be recited, but on Saturday the Lord of Living, the absolution, and the prayer of incense without the kiss shall be recited. The dead shall not be enshrouded on Saturdays, on Sunday, nor shall there be any weeping on Easter Day. And the canon also says that there shall be no joyful feast, nor shall there be any weeping, ordination of priests, baptisms, or weddings during the fast, with the exception of prayers for the dying and the baptism of those who are in danger of dying. Gloss. This is found in the canons of the kings. The rule concerning the great feast is that it must last for 8 weeks. It begins at the end of winter. This does not mean that Keramt of Ethiopia and ends at the beginning of summer, with 5 days of fasting each week. People shall eat on Saturday, which is the feast of the ancient law, and on Sunday, which is the feast of the new law. People shall not eat seasoned food. The fast of Wednesdays and Fridays shall always be observed, except the feast of Christmas and baptism, and during the 50 days between Easter and Pentecost, for the love of God. His obedient servants are obliged to observe the fast of his disciples after the feast of Pentecost, with the exception of Saturdays and Sundays. Chapter 16. Alms. To give alms is one of the acts of mercy. It is an act of man's pity, done with his own property for those who are in need, without any desire to be repaid by them, but done to fulfill the command of our Lord, who said, "Sell that you possess, and give alms to the poor. Make to yourselves bags which grow not old, a treasure in heaven, which is neither corruptible nor transitory." Our Lord has also said, "Give alms, and everything will be clean to you." Through alms, a man emulates his Creator to the extent he can, because to give alms and to be merciful is an attribute of the divine nature. And our Lord has said, "Be merciful as your heavenly Father." Alms are a loan made to God, and to give them is also a sure and profitable trade with God. They are a deposit which a wise man entrusts to the Lord, his God, for as long as he wishes. They are an acceptable offering placed upon a reasonable altar. And the Lord, may his name be exalted, has said, "I desire alms and not sacrifice." Moreover, as the prophet has said, fasting is accepted with alms. And as it was said to Cornelius, with alms the prayer is also accepted, as is written of the 5 foolish virgins. Without the giving of alms, virginity itself is of no value. The provisions and parables regarding alms contained in the holy books are innumerable. Our Lord has said concerning alms, "Give to him that asks of thee." And he also said, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy." He also said to the merciful, "Go into the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." There is also the saying of the Apostle Paul, "Do not forget mercy towards the poor. Be their companions. By such sacrifice man fulfills the pleasure of God." The utility of alms may be considered from many points of view. The first is that all people, rich or poor, must give what they can afford, and reward for giving depends on the intention of the giver, regardless whether he gives much or little. With regard to the rich, there is the saying of the Highest, to whomsoever much is given, of him much shall be required, and the saying, whosoever has loved much, much will he be forgiven him. So also his saying, "Give, and it shall be given to you with full, superabundant and overwhelming measure in your bosom. For with the same measure that you shall meet, it shall be measured to you." The Apostle Paul has also reiterated the word of his Lord and has said, "He who sparingly shall also reap sparingly, but he who sows in a blessing shall also reap in blessing." Every man does as he deems in his heart. Commend the rich of this world not to be high-minded, but to be joyful in giving and obeying, in order to lay down for themselves a good foundation for the time to come. As for the poor, when the woman offered the 2 mites, our Highest Lord said, "She has given all the living she has, while the others have given of their surplus." He also said, "Whosoever has given you a cup of cool water to drink in my name, because you belong to Christ, amen, I say to you, he shall not lose his reward." The Highest Lord has also said with the mouth of the prophet Isaiah, "Share thy bread between thee and the hungry." The apostles have also said in the Didascalia, "Love the Lord with your wealth that he was given to you. In the measure you can, what you can give to him, cast it in the box of alms, either 1 or 2 or 3 mites, and if you want to obey God, be the companion of the pilgrims with your wealth. As for the bread which is given to the poor from the toils of widows, it is truly layable and acceptable even if it is little. He who has nothing shall fast and shall give to the saints half of his bread. The alms which a person must give are two types, alms given secretly, alms given publicly. In the first case, the alms go from the giver to the needy, the hungry, the thirsty, the naked, the sick, the prisoners, and the exiled, pursuant to the following saying of our Lord, may he be praised, but let thy alms be in secret, and thy Father who sees in secret will repay thee openly, and pursuant to what he will say on the day of judgment to those who will stay at his right. His apostle Paul also said, and do not forget to accept the pilgrims, for they by some had the lot to receive, all unaware pilgrims who were angels. Remember the prisoners, as if you were in fetters together with them. Alms given publicly are those brought by the giver to the priest charged with receiving them. Such alms are tithes, first fruits, and vows, pursuant to the words of the apostles who said, the tithes, first fruits, and vows which are brought to the church as the Lord has commanded shall be shared between the servant of God. The part brought to the poor, as it is a thing of which God shall ask account, because he has entrusted this administration to their hands so that they may divide it among the very needy, shall be administered by good administrators, who shall divide it among the orphans, widows, those in distress, and also pilgrims who are in need. Do not dissipate the property of the church, neither shall you consume nor spend it for your own use. Between yourselves only, rather, you shall help the needy with it, so that it will be a right path for you before the Lord. Hear what was said at the beginning, and we repeat it to you. The vows, the tithes, and the first fruits mentioned above are destined for the highest priest of Christ and for the person who serves him. The tithes, the first fruits, and the vows which you must give should be brought to him who is the priest appointed to ensure that no one takes twice or more than once in a day or in a week, while there are others who have not yet received anything. He who knows is in distress and provides to each one as it is necessary. Bring to him the first fruits, your tithes, of your crops and of your handicraft, so that he may bless you. You shall give to him your first fruits, your vows, and your gifts, and from the fruits that ripen first of your wine, oil, fruits, wool, and every other thing which God has granted to you, because he is the priest of the Lord, so that your offering may be accepted and your incense pleasant before the Lord your God, and so that he may bless the work of your hands and make most abundant to you the fruit of the land, since blessing descends on those who give alms. Alms should be given to some in preference to others. Although everyone may give alms as he wishes, alms should first be given to the one who is in difficulty, to supply him with what he needs. Such worthy recipients are martyrs, then clergymen, then Christians, relatives, then all the faithful, and then the infidels. In conformity with what the apostle said, a widow who is self-supporting is not a poor widow. But if she is poor through sickness, or too poor to bring up her children, or poor because of physical weakness, stretch your hand more often to her, in consideration of her condition. If any of the faithful have relatives who are widows, they shall help them, so that the church may not be burdened with them, since those who are truly helpless widows are a sufficient burden to the church. The priests who execute their duties properly shall be given double honor, especially those who labor with words and teachings. Paul has also said, if any man has relatives, especially if they are faithful, and take no care to be useful to them, he has denied his faith, and is worse than the infidels. Now, therefore, while we have time, let us do good towards all men, and especially towards those who belong to the faith. According to the word of our Lord, who said, give to him that ask of thee, and do not frustrate the hope of another. Be you perfect as your heavenly Father who reigns upon the just and the unjust. Alms should be given to all the needy, be they Christian or infidels, good or bad. Give to the needy even if they do not belong to Christ. Therefore, as one must be mindful to give alms, he must give in the most perfect of times. Although it is good to give alms on other occasions as well, the principal days are Sundays and feast days, as indicated by the following words of the Lord in the Pentateuch concerning feast days. Do not appear with empty hands before the Lord your God on feast days, but every one of you shall offer part of that given to him by God in the measure that he can, so that the Lord your God may bless you. The apostle also said to the Corinthians, as for the collections that are made for the saints, as I have ordered the church of Galatia, so you shall do also. On Sunday, let every one of you put something apart in his house, in the measure that he can. Everyone shall be careful in this, so that there may be no quarrel among you at any time of my coming to you. The giving of alms is necessary at all times, and the words said about this are the following, saying of our Lord, give to him that ask of thee, and the word of Paul, who said, while we have life, let us do good, and also the word of the apostles, do not cease to give as long as you have something to give, because the day of our Lord is near, and alms must be given to those mentioned previously. They shall not be given to others, because the apostles have said, if one consumes his substance badly and improperly, in drunkenness or in laziness, and the poor widows of this world are driven to misery, the one who behaves thus shall not be helped. It is proper, then, that the needy receive alms and pray for those who grant alms to them. Those who are not needy must not receive alms, as the following saying of the apostle shows. Blessed is he who can help himself by his own work and maintain himself by his substance, who does not cast in misery the orphans, the pilgrims, and the widows. For as the Lord has said, more blessed is he that gives than he who receives. He also said, woe to him who has substance and receives alms, and also to him who can maintain himself and wants to take from others. God shall ask account of him in the day of judgment. But he who receives alms because he is an orphan, old, or sick, or because there are many who are fed by him, must not be blamed. It will be to his glory, and the Lord will honor him because it is considered as a sacrifice offered to God. He shall always pray for those who give him alms. He shall not take lazily what he receives, but for the honor given to him, he shall return to the persons who gave him alms more reward in the form of prayers for them, to the extent that he can. Paul also said, whoever will not work, he shall not eat. Everyone must believe that alms purify from sin, forgive the fault, and save from evil. Because of giving them, one receives a double reward. He who, while able, neglects to give alms, is like the infidel and the wicked. Our Lord has also said, give alms, and all things shall be clean for you. The apostles also have said the same in the Didaskalia. Similarly, Daniel has said, O king, let my counsel be acceptable to thee. Give alms so that thy sin may be forgiven with alms, and thy iniquities with having mercy to the poor. David also has said, blessed is he who has understanding concerning the needy and the poor. The Lord will deliver him on the day of evil. Solomon also said, he that satisfieth the need of the poor, it shall be given to him, and he will be rewarded double what he gave. He that stops his pity for not hearing the cry of the poor, neither will his imploring be heard when he will implore. He who has relatives, especially if they are among the faithful, and does not bother to help them, denies the faith and is worse than the infidels. The gospel also speaks about what our Lord will say to those who will stay at his left, such as the rich man who did not give to the poor Lazarus and the five foolish virgins. Whosoever wants to be perfect must give all his property in alms. However, not everyone must give away all his property in alms. The first is born out of the words of our Lord, who said, if thou wilt be perfect, so go sell what thou hast and give to the poor. And the second is demonstrated by the word of Paul, who said, in this present time, let your condition be equal to those about you, and what is in abundance to you may supply their want, and what is in abundance to them may supply your want. The following are some specific provisions on the law of alms, that it must not be given with hypocrisy, that it must be given joyfully without sorrow, and that one must not repent having given it. He who gives alms must be a lover of men, such as a person who is not haughty towards the one to whom he gives alms. He must not ask for an account of it from the bishop, must not investigate into its administration, and must not doubt, but must know that the Lord shall reward him for it. The substance to be given in alms shall be blameless. This is in conformity with the words of our Lord, who said, "Do not give your alms before men to be seen by them, otherwise you shall not have the reward of your heavenly Father. If thou givest alms, sound not a trumpet, as the hypocrites do in the assembly and in the street, so that they may be honored by men. Amen. I say to you, they have their reward. Do not be sad when you give alms to your brother, as the apostles have said, 'Every one of you shall give alms as he has determined in his heart, and not with oppression or sadness, for God loves a cheerful giver.' The apostle has also said, 'If I shall distribute all my goods to feed the poor and have not charity, it profits me nothing.' Do not drive away the poor from the door of your house, and do not be heedless of his words. Do not reproach nor despise him, but respect him wholeheartedly, and console him and render him cheerful, so that the Lord may render you cheerful. Make him sit down with you at your table, and give him drink in the glass that you drink with. Do not be proud towards him. You shall not call the bishop to account for the alms given, or inquire about the administration of alms, that is, what he does with them, when, where, and to whom he gives them, or if he administers the alms as properly as he should, because God has entrusted this administration to him. If you have property and give it away to achieve with it the salvation of your soul from sins, do not be double-hearted. If you have given away your property, know who it is who will reward you. The apostles have also prohibited accepting alms from the hands of the wicked, as already said in the chapter on the Eucharist. The apostles have said, 'If you say, they are the ones who give alms, and if we do not accept it from them, with what will we feed the widows, and with what will we bring up the orphans, and with what we give to the needy who are among the people? Hear us. Do you not take out of this necessity the honor which is the first fruits of corn of the Levites? And it is not taking the first fruits given to you by the people sufficient for yourselves and the needy. Do not take then anything from the wicked. If all the community does this, and there is no goodness among men, it is better for you to die, to perish of starvation, than for you to receive anything from the enemy of God. And if he who accepts alms from the wicked should be put to shame and derision among his companions, as regard them, the prophet has said, let not the oil of sinners fatten my head. Let every one of you prove himself and accept the alms of all those who are righteous in their conduct. It has also been said, if by necessity you accept the money from he whom you do not like, that is, from an impure man, an infidel, use it to buy wood for fire, so that the widows and the orphans may not take it, and may not desire to buy with it food and drink in an improper manner. It is right that this substance of the impious become the food of the fire, and not the food of the saints. He who has amassed the wealth for himself, and is suspected of having committed injustice in collecting it, must not amass it unjustly and without good counsel, planning to use it for alms. For he must realize that by this act he does not obliterate his sin. Rather, he must repent of his deeds and return the substance to the one from whom he took it unjustly. If he cannot do so, he shall divide it and give it to the poor, as commanded by the Lord in the Pentateuch and the Gospel. The command of the highest God contained in the Pentateuch says that those who take someone's property by violence must return forthwith what they took fivefold of it, and must offer sacrifice to the Lord. If the person who has robbed, or any of his relatives, cannot be found, it shall be offered to God, and given to the priest together with the sacrifice. The Gospel also commands this, on the basis of what our Lord said in the parable. He told about the unjust steward who gathered the debtors of his landlord, and left them half of what was due to his landlord. The evangelist says that God, praise the unjust steward because he acted as a prudent man would. And our Lord said, And I say to you, make yourselves friends with wealth acquired unjustly, so that when you have finished, they may receive you into everlasting dwellings. He also said, If you have not been faithful in unjust wealth, who will trust you with that which is true? And if you have not been faithful in that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own? Our Lord praised the prostitute who gave her property for his service when she repented for her sins. Moreover, the Lord did not drive away Zacchaeus and deny him the hope of being saved when the latter said to him, If I have wronged any man of anything, I will restore him fourfold. I will give half of all my goods to the poor. As the book of the apostles shows, the apostles used to take the property of the faithful and give to each man according to his needs. And it is known that because the people around the apostles were numerous and were not all believers, the apostles did not accept their alms if there were among them any who had blemishes with regard to their property. However, the disciples used to accept their alms as soon as they repented and became members of the faithful. They used to give the alms to the poor. And St. Gregory, the theologian, has said at the beginning of the homily delivered after his silence, If the thing to be given in alms is something which cannot be offered, it is a small thing. If it is a small thing, the giver makes it against the command of the upright God. We should not accept things originally acquired with injustice. And what is it to be offered, if collected from anywhere, shall not be accepted. Chapter 15. The one in charge of goods given in alms, the property of the church, and the offerings made to the church, how they must be given and distributed, and other related matters. This chapter is divided into three parts. Part 1. That the bishop be responsible for all property of the church and use it to support himself and the priests and deacons who are poor. We order that the bishop have power over the property of the church. If the honored souls of the people are entrusted to him, what are all the properties and wealth which are given to him to administer, and with which he may, as he sees fit, feed the poor through the hands of the priests and deacons, fearing God and trembling, and also let them take from the property and give according to their need, to the brothers who are in need and to the pilgrims who want to visit the bishop. The apostles used to give of the things brought to them, to everyone according to his need. The bishop shall take care of whatever is in the church and shall dispose of it as one under the surveillance of God does. He shall not make profit from it for himself only to use it for trading, nor shall he give the property of God to his own relatives, even if they are poor. Nor shall he trade with the property of the church under the pretext of helping the clergy who are in need. If he does not abstain from doing these things, and spends the property to feed himself and to provide for the expenses of the people of his house, and does not show the goods of the church to the priests and deacons, let him go out, together with the people of his family. The priest or deacon who was with him shall not go out, and the bishop shall not go far from the church, lest on this account the community of the faithful murmur against him. The goods of the church must be known by the priests and deacons, known to be of good reputation, as must the property of the bishop. If the bishop dies, neither his property nor that of the church, which is to be set apart after, being recognized, shall be dissipated. All the belongings of the church of God, such as clothing, golden and silver objects, fields, vineyards, animals, and other similar things shall be kept by people who fear God and are trustworthy. If any priest or other person dare sell any of these belongings, he must retrieve what he sold from the one to whom he sold it. And similarly, the one who has brought the thing and has it in his possession must give it back. If the property of the church is not given back to the church, the punishment of the seller and the buyer shall be to restore double of what they took according to the judgment of the bishop. The latter shall decide this matter as he as he deems proper in the fear of God. If anyone dies and bequeaths his property to the church, and if the property consists of gold, clothing, copper, or crops, the administrator designated by the bishop or the priest of the church shall take it. But if it is an object which is subject to taxation or to tithe by the king, it shall not be accepted. The church must not be under the royal power. Part 2. On the necessity of appointing administrators for the income and expenditures of the church, and on the necessity of giving separate places for the sick and pilgrims, and appointing assistants for them. A keeper and administrator shall be appointed for each church to administer the expenditures and the income of the church. Each of the administrators shall be assigned specific duties relating to the office of keeping by those who appointed them to these duties in the uprightness of God. None of them shall be like the wicked servant who hid the gold of his master, did not trade with it, and so did not gain either one or five. A separate dwelling place shall be reserved in every city for the pilgrims, the poor, and the sick, and the bishop shall choose a foreign monk of the character from a distant country and appoint his administrator of this place. The appointed monk shall not leave the city, but shall take a house for the dwelling there, and shall prepare enough beds and blankets and other things which the sick and the poor need. In the church, if the church does not own much property, he shall, whenever it is necessary, collect food for the sick and the poor from the faithful, to the extent they can afford to give. Because of this act of charity, many sins are forgiven. It is an offering made to God. The inhabitants of the country shall choose in every settlement a man who lives alone, apart from the people, and who is of good character. They shall allot to him a separate room, near the church or near the houses of the sick, for dwelling. The property of the sick shall be deposited with him. He shall have responsibility for the pilgrims and the sick. He shall supervise them. He shall visit also the Christians who are in prison, and shall do nothing except what they desire. If they desire something, he shall seek it for them among the faithful, be they men or women. As for the prisoner who has committed a grave crime, if he cannot find a way to save and release him, he shall take care of him and provide with him food and clothing. If any of the faithful is unable to pay debt, the man responsible for the pilgrims and the sick shall give him what is in his possession. If he cannot find the means to pay the debt from others, if the people choose a distinguished man to be administrator for the sick, and that man refuses what is required from him, he shall be prevented from associating with the community. No administrator shall be appointed over one appointed before until the death of the latter, or unless he commits a fault for which his degree must be shorn from him. In this case, he shall be excommunicated. The administration belongs to him unless his fault is proved. If he is weak, the bishop shall give him another administrator. The bishop shall also deliver the administrator the utensils for the use of the sick. Part 3. The distribution of alms. This part is divided into three sections. First, all tithes go to the priest and to those who are responsible for alms. The second is from the same canon. That is, the first fruits, that is, the first thing, belongs solely to the clergy and to those who are at the service of the clergy. The bishop shall take the first fruits and shall bless them, mentioning the name of the one who brought the first fruits to him, and say, We thank thee, O Lord, because thou hast commanded the loud to produce all the fruits on the trees, to the joy and food of all men and animals. To thee we offer the first fruits that thou hast given to us to feed ourselves with. The following are the fruits that must be blessed: grapes, figs, pomegranates, olives, apples, peaches, and cherries. The following must not be blessed: sycamores, onions, garlic, melons, gourds, and other kinds of vegetables. People shall also offer roses, but not offer flowers. They shall eat everything that is edible and shall thank and glorify God. Third, what is left over from the sacrifice of the Mass and not offered on the altar shall be shared by the deacons according to the advice of the bishop of the priest. They shall give 4 parts to the bishop, 3 parts to the priest, and 2 parts to the deacons. As for the others, such as the subdeacons, the lectors, the singers, and the deaconesses, 1 part shall be given to each one of them. And this is good and acceptable before God, that is, that each one be honored according to his rank.